is power, power. Here in this hour, this hour. We're all together, together. Waiting here as one. There is power, power. Here in this hour, this hour. We're all together, together. Waiting here as one.
Good morning. Good morning and welcome to worship. Today we are glad you are here. We want to extend a special hello to the online viewers and invite you to make your presence known. If you're joining us in the sanctuary, please fill out your connection card and place it in the offering plates. This not only helps us take attendance, but if you include your email and address, it helps us communicate with you and let you know what is going on in and around the church. If this is your first time joining us, please be sure to pick up a welcome bag from the table in the entryway. It has lots of information about the church and to help you get acquainted with us. Mark your calendar now for later this month, Monday and Tuesday, August 29th and 30th. That is the day we'll be taking pictures for our new updated directory, almost like back to school time here with pictures. We'd love for all regular attendees to be in the directory regardless of your membership status. Also, if you have family members that do not attend the church but would like a portrait, it is free to sit for a portrait, and they will receive a free picture without obligation to purchase any additional pictures as well. Stacy Urich will be signing you up today, or you can go online to pick a time to do that. Also coming up in a couple of weeks, Youth Sunday is on the 21st of August, so we hope you will plan to join us that day, as our youth have an active part in leading that service. August newsletters are on the welcome table for you to pick up as well, and please check your bulletin for more announcements. I think we have more to do with the youth here.
I just wanted to give you an update of what we've been doing this summer with the youth group. We have a couple of pictures to show you. So this was the baseball game we went to. Had a good time. Helped with the backpack event, and we went to the movies, and then we had a water day. And if you notice there in the corner, they did get me. with a big giant thing of water. And then this last Friday, we had a lock-in, and it went really well. You'd be happy to know we did not do Nerf guns, so you will not find bullets all over the church for the next several months. But we did do pie in the face and some outdoor stuff. And if you notice in the corner, they do this game where you play security, and they've got all these cameras posted in the church. And that's Violet's face right there, sticking her face in the camera. So we had a good time, and just wanted to give you an update on what we were doing all summer. And we start back next week with our regular week stuff and have more fun to come.
Awesome. So again, Youth Sunday on the 21st of August, but will you please stand and join me in our morning prayer as we start today? Lord, thank you for joining us all together again today. We thank you for the weather. We thank you for the men and women in uniform in both the armed forces and also in the police and fire department. Keep them safe as they go throughout their daily lives, and that you can protect them from harm as they serve this country, our city, and our state. We pray for everybody who is dealing with cancer and other health issues, that you give them healing and that you can keep them and help get rid of those diseases. And we also pray for their caregivers and families, that they can help them and give them the best care as possible. We pray for this church, and we pray for Anne as she gives a message today, and everybody else who is involved today as well. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray, amen.
I wait, my soul waits for the Lord. My hope is in His word. More than the watchman waits for dawn, my soul I cry to you. In darkest places I will call. Incline your ear to me anew, and hear my cry for mercy, Lord. Were you to count my sinful ways, how could I come before your throne? Yet full forgiveness meets my
soul is satisfied.
be seated, and boys and girls, you may come forward at this time.
Good morning. So I have a question for you. Have any of you been sick before? Yeah, how about, have you gotten hurt? Obviously, Violet is demonstrating that for me this morning. So what do we do when we're sick? Let we rest, relax. What else? Do we take anything to help us feel better? Sometime medicine, yeah. What about when we're hurt? What helps us? We go to the hospital, and what do they give us? They give us these kind of things, don't we, to help us. So does these devices and like Band-Aids and stuff and medicine, do they heal us completely? No, they just kind of help us along. What heals us completely? God. And how does he do that? Lucy says, it's magic. Yes, so he made us to so our body will heal, right? But does that always happen in every instance? Do we always heal? No, and does it take sometimes longer than what we think it should take? It does, it does. So Jesus healed people, didn't he? Can you give me an example? Okay, yes, the sick and the crippled, yeah, uh-huh. Yeah, exactly. But sometimes we don't always get healed like we think we should or in the time frame that we think we should. But you know, there's one cool thing that God always promises he will heal, and what is that? Your heart. Good job. Someone might have been reading my notes or something. Since she is my daughter. So he always promises to heal our hearts. And he did that by choosing to die so that he could take all of our sins away and heal the sin sickness in our hearts. So I want you to remember that this morning, that even though sometimes the physical things take longer, we'll always know that he'll heal our hearts, okay? Can we pray? Dear God, we thank you for your message. We thank you that you help us open our hearts and our minds to you and that we learn more about you each day. And we thank you for these children that come and learn about you. And even though some of us come today not feeling well or injured, we know that you're in the midst of all of it. And we just thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Miss Christie. You can see my Jackson got a little scared there at the end. I don't know why he got so shy all of a sudden. Usually he's like waving at his fans, so I don't know where that came from this morning. We're glad you're here. I know that Stacy Urick sent out an email that told you about Jenny Smith falling and breaking her arm. And her leg, but she actually called the church and said, I didn't break my leg, I only broke my foot. So she said, I want people to know I'm not as crippled up as people think. So it's her arm and her foot. And I know there's a lot of people that have prayer requests this morning, that things within your body don't seem to be working, or maybe there are things within your emotions that are happening, or you're walking through a season of grief, or whatever it is. You're in the right place. So glad you're here. We're going to have the worship team call us to prayer, and then I'm going to give you some time to talk to Jesus.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship. Joy, my
Father God, what a joy it is to be in your house this morning. And we praise your holy name, Lord, because you're worthy of all our praise. You are loving and kind and holy and righteous. And yet, you still take notice of us. And you love us as your own. And even though outside these walls the world is chaotic, we thank you that we can find a sweet respite in this place. A place where we know you love us and we are loved by the fellowship of believers. Thank you, Lord, for that. Thank you for drawing us together, Lord, so that we can prepare our hearts and minds for the rest of the week. Father, for those who were not here this morning, whether it is because of illness or travel or just a hectic life, Lord, we ask your mercy on them. Lord, we pray for the people who have not yet found their way here, but we still ask you to just tug at their hearts, to pull them into this place where they will find your love, your hospitality. Father, for the things that are happening in our world that seem beyond our control, help us remember, Lord, that you are still on the throne and nothing escapes your gaze. And Father, as we remember the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, we lift our voices as one saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to continue now in our time of worship as we offer back to God his tithes and our offerings.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Singing of the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Let's pray, church. Father, we thank you. We thank you for this day. We thank you for the ability that we get from you to partner with you with these, your tithes and our offerings, as we continue to advance your kingdom and glorify your name. We love you, Jesus, and it's in your precious name we pray these things. Amen. You may be seated. Last week, I reminded you that we are in the season of what we call on the church calendar ordinary time. And you may or may not remember that the church calendar is actually divided into two halves, just about. There's one season or cycle that has all the high holy days in it: Advent, Christmastide, Easter, Lent, Pentecost. And then the other season in the church, the other cycle, is called ordinary time. And that doesn't mean that nothing extraordinary is happening in the church. It just means that the Sundays are counted in numbered order. First Sunday after Pentecost, second Sunday after Pentecost. So actually this purpose of this ordinary season, it really just means counted Sundays. And the reason that we have this season of ordinary time is it serves as a purpose of growth for new disciples and seasoned disciples. This is the season for growing your gifts and your graces that you have been given by Holy Spirit for the purpose of advancing the kingdom of God, and you're walking into your own calling. And for this season of growth, we join God in this advancement of his kingdom here on earth. And I love that, at least in our part of the world, the season of ordinary time, the season of growth, happens during the summer and the fall, when we see the season of growth all around us in nature and all around us in the fields that surround us. Any gardener knows that this is the growing season in summer and fall. And also gardeners know that you never just put a seed in the ground for no reason. You plant a seed for a purpose. You don't just put a seed in the ground just to put a seed in the ground. Of course, unless you're a kid, and then it's just fun to play in the dirt. So, but I'm talking about gardeners who are regularly put a seed in the ground. They are expecting growth. Whether it's flower or food, they're expecting growth to occur. And as we see this season of growth in nature around us and in our own home gardens, that should remind us that this is the season for growing in our purpose in our own Christ-like walk. Because when Holy Spirit has been planted in our hearts, then we should expect growth to occur. If you've been changed by the gospel, then that change should be affected in the way that you live your life. Your life should be evidence of growing and maturing and bringing forth fruit in the kingdom. Last week we talked about remembering our baptism, and we remembered that at our baptism we were claimed, we were named and claimed by Holy Spirit. And we receive the power of the Holy Spirit in our baptism. And this morning we're beginning a short sermon series about growing in purpose, growing in the Spirit, growing in direction by the planting of Holy Spirit in our hearts. And today our sermon is going to be focusing on growing in purpose, because it takes a lot of focus to grow into your purpose. You have to be focused about what we do. And in our scripture today from Mark, the first chapter in verses 32 through 39, we see that very early on in his ministry, from the very beginning, Jesus was very focused in what his purpose here on earth was to be. And so this is Mark 1, verses 32 through 39. I'm going to be reading this morning from the New Revised Standard Version. That evening at sunset, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed by demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. And when they found him, they said, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that's what I came to do." And he went throughout all Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. It's really apparent from this scripture that Jesus was under a lot of pressure to heal those that needed healing and give hope to those that were hopeless. The passage is set up as it was evening time. It was sunset. If that were in today, like today, that would be like 9 o'clock at night. And I will have to tell you that if someone came to my door at 9 o'clock at night, you might find me in my jammies. And if you wanted me to heal you or cast out demons, I probably would need a caffeinated beverage to do so before I tried. But if it were sunset, I'm guessing that Jesus probably had already kicked off his sandals, and perhaps he was starting to prop up his feet to rest after a long day of being the Son of God. And then all of a sudden, there's a knock at the door. And I can almost hear Jesus sigh. "Okay, guys, put your sandals back on. We got work to do." And as the disciples look out the window of the house where they're standing, they don't just see one or two people standing there. The whole town, it says, had come out. There were hundreds of people lined up, and not one of them had a coffee cake in their hands wanting to say, "Welcome to the neighborhood." They were all there to get something from him. They all needed something from him. Talk about pressure. You could just hear him, "Master, my son is lame. Can you help him?" "Rabbi, my daughter, she's deaf. Can you heal her?" "Jesus, my brother is demon possessed. Can you cast it out?" "Jesus, help me. Jesus, have mercy on me. Help me, give me, heal me." Pressure, pressure, pressure. Have you ever had a day in your own life where everywhere you turn, somebody needs you or wants something from you? And they need it right now and they want it right now. And you basically become a fireman. You just go out putting one fire out to the next. Maybe you've had a day like this. You get to work, there's 125 unopened emails that you have to check. The phone never stops ringing, and you find out that you have completely overbooked yourself. You have double booked yourself. You are overscheduled, so when you leave, you really feel like you got nothing done. And then you get home, and you realize that you forgot to turn on your crock pot. And so the roast that was sitting in your crock pot that was supposed to be cooked is still just as raw as it was as you left it in the morning. And now you have to throw it out because it's been sitting at room temperature for 8 hours. And so you think to yourself, "Okay, you know what? We're going to go to Mexican. We're going to do Mexican because that'll be quick. That'll get everybody in the car." You drive to the Mexican restaurant. You get there and you realize that they are totally understaffed. Way too many people there. Well, because guess what? It's Taco Tuesday. So you sit down, you order your food. It takes forever to get there. And the drinks, the carbonated drinks, really, I wouldn't ever get my kids caffeinated drinks, but the carbonated drinks that you get your kids are flat. So they complain. All except for the little one. The little one ordered lemonade. So her drink was fine, and so she gets 3 refills, which means she has to go to the bathroom 3 times. And so the last time you get into the bathroom with her, you're like, "No, don't touch anything. Things are not clean in here, honey. Don't touch anything. Don't touch anything." And you lift her up to the sink. She insists on turning on the spigot herself. And when she does, water squirts out everywhere, and it gets her soaked and you soaked as well. So then now you put her back down on the floor, and you say, "Now, don't touch anything. Don't touch anything." But what she does, she steps right in the puddle that made from the water that squirted out, and she falls down, and she puts both hands right on the floor. That may or may not have been based on a day I had not too long ago. I don't know if you've ever had a day like that, but I'm pretty sure you've had a day similar to that. So you get in the picture? Pressure, pressure, pressure. How do we handle that pressure? Because pressure's everywhere around us. And we want to be able to live out our Christian witness without blowing a gasket. So what did Jesus do under all the pressure he had? So let's look back for a minute at the Mark passage, and let's look what verse 35 says. Verse 35 says, "Very early in the morning, while it was still dark, Jesus got up, left the house, and went off to a solitary place where he prayed." Real early in the morning, he left his house, and he went to a solitary place where he could pray. Jesus knew that pressure was coming, and so he needed to start his day in solitude with his Father, receiving the power he needed to walk forward in his purpose. He started in silence and solitude. And church, before we get ready for our day, every day, in this world full of pressure, not knowing what we're going to face when we step outside the door, or even when we stay inside and things assault us, we need to fill up our spiritual tank, because we cannot face the world on an empty tank. So how do we do that? How do we do that? Well, I'm going to suggest this to you. When you wake up in the morning, instead of reaching for your phone, resist that temptation. Instead of turning on the TV to see the news, resist that urge. Instead of going to your computer and checking your email and checking into social media, resist that. Because if you want to be filled with the Spirit, you need to fulfill your purpose. You need to plug into Jesus first before you plug into the world. So you've got to unplug from the world and plug in to God. Before Jesus faced the pressure of the day, he plugged in to his Father. He spent time alone with the Father praying. He made a point to spend quality time in prayer with God. And when his disciples found him, they're like, "Dude, everybody is looking for you." Like, they're searching. They wake up, he's not there. "Oh my gosh, where he is? Look at all these people at the door. We got to get going." But that's the precise reason that Jesus had to refill his tank. That's exactly the reason that Jesus had to plug into the Father, why he had to spend solitude with God before he was ready for the purpose of the day. He had to focus first with prayer. And the disciples said, "Everybody's looking for you." No doubt there was probably already a line forming again outside, because you know that the people that got healed the night before went back and told other people. And we don't have to know how, I don't even know how late Jesus stayed up that night. I mean, if there was 100 people at his door at 9 o'clock at night, was it midnight? 1 o'clock? Before he got to sleep that night? Exhausted? So in the morning, he had to walk away, not because he was walking away from the helpless and the hopeless. He walked away to fill his tank. He walked away because he needed to get away in solitude to talk with God. And church, if we don't take time to do that, if we don't spiritually fill up our tank, we're not going to be able to walk forward in our purpose. And that is a word for somebody this morning. You need to take a minute and take stock of where your gas gauge is in your spiritual gas tank. Where are you? Are you taking time out to attend to your own spiritual needs? You cannot begin to take care of other people if you don't take care of yourself. You don't have to be the sacrificial lamb. There was only one sacrificial lamb, and you're not it, and I'm not it. And even when I was writing this sermon and I was typing those words on my computer, God said to me, "Are you listening?" Because I know I tend to be that kind of person, that I like to attend to everybody else, sometimes at the expense of my own sanity. But I know I'm not the only one. I know I'm not the only one. So we have to stop, and we have to refill our tanks. And I know that in order to fulfill my purpose and for you to fulfill your purpose, we have to spend time in conversation with God. We have to take stock of our own spiritual health. Fill up our own spiritual tanks. When Jesus spent time with the Father, he received the power that he needed to walk forward in his job as the Son of God. He received that power. It's like a pep talk every morning, getting what he needed. And when his friends found him, I think it's interesting that when his friends found him and were like, "Everybody's looking for you," he didn't act annoyed. He didn't act exhausted or worn out. He was like he was revived. He was rejuvenated. "Come on, let's go. I got a lot of people to see and a lot of things to do because that's why I came, to fulfill my purpose." So what does that mean for us in fulfilling our purpose? What should we do when we're under the gun and we feel the pressure and we feel like recoiling and getting in our little defensive mode? But no, we pray, church. That's the obvious answer, isn't it? We pray. We get quiet in a solitary place, and we have a conversation with God. And when we have that conversation with God, we do it with the expectation that we are going to be filled with the power that we need to fulfill our purpose. And the more pressure we're under, the more prayer we need. The more pressure you're under. And I know this is back to school time. Parents are like, "Oh my gosh, I have to get up at the crack of dawn. I got to get my kids to school. It's so hard." But the answer to that is to get up earlier. No one likes to hear that, but it's really the truth. Get up a little bit earlier. It's so worth it. It's so worth it to make time, make an appointment with God to talk to him. The more pressure, the more prayer is needed. And then I always have people that say, "But I don't know how to pray. I don't know what to say." But God just wants to hear your heart. And you know, there's lots of prayer patterns out there. We say one every morning, every Sunday morning. The Lord's Prayer is a prayer pattern. But I want to give you a really simple prayer pattern to remember this morning. And it's an acronym just based on the word pray, P-R-A-Y, pray. So the first one, P, stands for praise. When you begin in prayer, you praise God for who he is. You praise God for what he's done. And I know sometimes if you're in the middle of something really heavy, it's hard to think of something positive. But you know what? You can just say, "Father, I praise you that I woke up this morning and I have breath in my lungs. I praise you." P, praise. R, Repent. Repent. Be specific about the sins that you have committed. When I was a little girl, when I prayed, I'd be just like, please forgive me for everything I did. Amen. You know, like, and that's fine when you're little. But when you're big, or I never ever got big, but when I got older, I realized I have to be specific. I have to say, Lord, I'm sorry I was snappy with that person. I'm sorry that I put myself before you, or I put myself above my family. Repent. Be specific. Pour out your heart. You know, God already knows it. He already knows what you did. We might as well admit it. You can't hide anything from God. So P, praise. R, repent. A is ask. Go to God with your petitions, whatever they are, for yourself, but also as an intercessor for somebody else, to pray for healing, to pray for transformation, to pray for restored relationships. Ask. God knows your need, but he wants you to say it. He knows a word that before it's even on our tongue, he already knows it. But you need to claim it. Claim it. So we ask, we praise, we repent, we ask. And the last one is why yield. That's a hard one. We yield. We yield ourselves to God. We say, not my way, Lord, your way. Not my will, Lord, your will. Praise, repent, ask, and yield. Such a simple way to pray. And Lord, he knows all of our needs. He's going to fulfill all our needs, but sometimes we have to verbalize those things. And I'm not suggesting that you only spend 5 minutes a day praying, but if you're not somebody who prays on a regular basis, this is a super good, super easy way to start. And what happens when you begin to pray on a regular basis is that you begin to crave being in God's presence. You begin to crave that conversation with God. And remember, I said conversation, so that means you're not doing all the talking. You also have to do the listening. And so when you're praying, you better leave as much time in silence to hear the answer as you do making the requests and saying what's on your heart. You know, church, in this time of growth, this ordinary, really extraordinary time, what I pray for you is extraordinary growth in the Spirit. I'm praying for you to grow in your purpose here in God's kingdom. And that when you feel the pressure that the world has, that you will seek God out in prayer. And as you pray with expectation, the expectation that God will fill you with power that will allow you to fulfill your purpose. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for reminders from your word, Lord, that when we have so much going on, that the place to start our day, every day, is in a quiet, solitary place to seek you out. Father, help us be more like Jesus. Help us go to you in all things, seeking you out in the silence. As you pour out your power and your love on us, so that we can fulfill our purpose. Oh, how we love you, Jesus. And it's in your precious name that we pray these things. Amen.
There is never a time that I don't love coming to communion. It's one of the things I look forward to on Sunday mornings. And whenever I can't be here and participate in communion with you, I miss it. Because what a wonderful time. What a wonderful time to remember that Jesus says, when you do these things,
Do it in remembrance of me. Do it in the love that I had for you. Will you join me in the communion liturgy? The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 Lord God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church and delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. And on the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread. He gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine, and make them be for us your body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood, and by your Spirit make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. This is the body of Christ, broken for you. This is the blood of the Lamb poured out for you. I would ask the communion stewards to come forward at this time. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood of the Lamb poured out for you. The blood of the Lamb poured out for you. This is the blood of the Lamb poured out for you. The blood of the Lamb poured out for you. the blood of the Lamb poured out for you. You know, here in the United Methodist Church, of which West Newton United Methodist Church is part of, we believe in open communion, which means you do not have to be a member of this church in order to participate in Holy Communion. If you feel called by God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit to partake of the sacraments, we want you to come. It's our tradition that we start at the back of the aisle. The ushers will give you a little squirt of hand sanitizer, and you can come through the middle aisle, partake of the sacraments. You can kneel at the altar. If you wish to pray, you can take them back to your seats. If you do, you can put your used cups in the side dishes on the columns, or if you take it back to your seat, you can just put it in the little holder on the back of your pew. If you wish to receive an anointing of oil for healing, or to stand in the gap for someone else, or a blessing, you're welcome to do that as well. The table is open. Come to the table.
Will you stand as we sing our final hymn together? Going to be stuff out there waiting for you. But you know what? You have the fuel of the Holy Spirit to get you through all of it. So go now in the power and the presence of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And all God's children said, Amen. Amen.
Head down as I punch this clock. The hours roll, they never stop. And I can't ever seem to get ahead. Always trying to do what's right. Straight and narrow's getting tight. Don't know how much longer I can stand. And I'm wondering, yeah, I'm wondering, where's my promised land? All these seasons, I'm still believing.